It's a really big pleasure to have McKenzie Wark here, and I think we should probably try to keep everything to probably around 40 minutes or so, because our time is very short, and we'll try to allow around 15 minutes at the end for questions, I think. So to give you an idea of the kind of framework for this event, I wanted to have McKenzie here to understand some of the ideas that he's described in his essay "Designs for a New World," which is coming out in the next issue of e-flux journal. And this issue of the journal is something that we have edited together with Elizabeth Povinelli, who is an anthropologist based at Columbia, who and an idea that she has, a kind of conceptual framework that she uses the name of quasi-events to describe, and within this framework it has really wide implications, but I think the most succinct way of describing it would be to understand exertion and exhaustion as actually more constitutive of our being, and also our labor, than kind of romantic or idealistic notions that we encounter in our expectations of revolution, social movements, art, philosophy. And if we understand ourselves actually more in terms of our limitations, this can be a very productive way of also, if we transpose it onto notions of abstraction that we encounter within finance and within art, and something that she places within the liberal tradition, really, which is we can start to read what is happening around us in terms of the stresses that it places on our bodies and our minds and our psychology. I think this is a really important concept now because of the way, and this is something that also that Ken points to in his essay, to a really sophisticated problem that many artists are encountering now, which has to do with the fact that actually the liberal tradition, which art belongs to, also seems to share the same heritage as finance. So artistic abstraction and financial abstraction actually have so much in common that it becomes actually very hard to identify how class functions in this framework, and how to actually intervene into these abstractions. So as a media theorist, Ken is extremely deft at also negotiating this territory and identifying ways to intervene. So just to give a bit of background on Ken, he is an Australian-born writer and scholar, and he's known for his writings on media theory, critical theory, new media, and the situation is international, and books which you probably know, such as the Hacker Manifesto and Gamer Theory. So sorry, that introduction probably took up half of our time.
That's how it always happens. Yeah. Can everybody hear for that? Okay. Who reads e-flux? You know what e-flux? If you don't, if you just Google e-flux, you'll find it. And the wonderful thing is most of your stuff is free online, yeah? There's also there's also awesome books out there, but the stuff gets redacted later. Who's heard of Elizabeth Povinelli? We have a few takers. Who is an anthropologist who I think is teaching at Columbia, who I only met once, and you know, I had lunch with her once. And I found her really interesting because she works on Australian Indigenous stuff, which I have not worked on, but the writing on which I follow. So I found that really interesting that she knew people I knew and was working in parts of the country I know. And the thing about anthropology is it gets interesting when it starts to deal with these sort of minor forms of practice that are neither new nor traditional and don't really fit the sort of abstract grand abstractions of theory terribly well, but where its practitioners are kind of interested in how you would produce concepts for the rest of us, if you like, out of these kind of minor practices. So it's a kind of writing I follow, and I thought Beth Povinelli was a really interesting kind of exponent of that. And exhaustion seems to be one of those minor figures to, you know, what are the ways you sort of start to use this language to describe practices that you find that might get some purchase precisely because they're a little bit unexpected. And that was one that struck me as kind of interesting. So these guys asked me to write in response to something that Beth wrote, which I did in the middle of finishing a book, so I now have no memory of it at all. So I wrote 2,000 words for these guys. I have absolutely no memory. I was like, I should have printed it out and brought it, because now I don't remember it at all. But what, that's kind of interesting. I could just like, or reinvent it, something completely different. Yeah. So ways of thinking about practices that are on the margins of, you know, everybody talks about how we move from formal to real subsumption. Everything's inside capitalism. It's like, not to ethnographers. You know, it's yes, you find these complex ways that the commodity form finds its way into the periphery, but it's not as if it's all become one absolutely homogenous space. It's really not quite, it's not quite how abstraction works. There's something a little bit missing in that form. So there are ways of thinking about labor that look at practices in the margins, but also in what you might think of as the overdeveloped worlds, which I think is the best way to describe where we actually are at this minute. Yeah, there's this old-fashioned sense that there's the developed world, and then there's the underdeveloped world, where we are somehow the standard everyone's supposed to aspire to. Yeah, but I think it makes more sense to think this is the overdeveloped world. We sort of overshot something at some point and went too far, and it's a little hard to describe exactly in what way it went too far. You could have different, you know, ideas about that. But to think this the overdeveloped world, so it's not the norm anymore. Yeah, it sort of takes this away as norm. So you can still talk about an underdeveloped and an overdeveloped, but it's not like there's some happy developed form of whatever this civilization is supposed to be. Because the one thing you can say about this civilization is it's not going to last, and we all know it. Yeah, and we will pretend I didn't say that for the next 40 minutes, because it's the unutterable thing, is we all know this can't go on. Yeah, we all know this has to be replaced by something else, or just, you know, fade into the dust, like Shelley's Osmandius poem, yeah, and just be done. So, how does one think about practices where one is in the margins of one's own overdeveloped situation? Because confronted with the blackmail of, like, you know, either it all has to be changed totally, or we just ignore the problem. Maybe it's better to sort of think, well, what, you know, what are the actual practices of the everyday? But not to kind of settle in that space then for the thought that I do my recycling, so it's not my problem. You know, to think a little bit more of the challenge of what, you know, forms of life might be in the 21st century. And so then what exactly is labor now might not be a bad place to start to, you know, what exactly, you know, because I'm not exactly sure when I'm at work anymore, yeah? I know I seem to be working ridiculous hours, but I'm not sure which hours are the ridiculous ones I'm working. Because I'll be, like, you know, basically asleep on the sofa, and then I'll, like, get up and go like this. Am I the only one who has this experience? Oh, crap, that's what I'm supposed to be doing, is this thing, and suddenly it all comes together. So is the sleeping on the sofa part of the work, you know? Because it seems kind of relaxing and fun. Yeah, and somehow that's more the work than the bit where you're doing this, which is just like being an automator. Yeah, I'm not really thinking when I do this. Yeah, it's like I have that idea, I'll just get it out now. So I don't think I'm the only one, that we all seem to work too freaking much, but as to which parts work is no longer clear. Yeah, because I'm from a steel town where people literally knocked off, and, you know, it was mostly men working in factories, and they would knock off, go to the pub, read the tabloid newspaper, which was called 1 Minute Silence, have a couple of drinks, talk to the mates, and they're done. Like, I don't even think about it. You don't think about work. Like, that's, why would you do that? You know, irrelevant. But that world is pretty much gone. Yeah, you're supposed to be in it all the time. So maybe this non-labor or some people call it playbur, where even all of your sort of creative, arty sort of things, and they're basically just work. You know, are there ways to get purchase to think about what activities we're obliged to do and what better activities might be, so that we might redesign forms of life in the 21st century? That seemed to me to be the kind of problem that Beth was opening up.
When you mentioned the overdeveloped and underdeveloped world, it actually reminds me of this notion of infrastructure, that proposed infrastructure that Elizabeth Povinelli deals with, where the exhaustion also comes from a certain kind of like parity or similarity between the overdeveloped world and the underdeveloped world, where no one is really dealing with infrastructure. It's the kind of like non-structural parallel between the favela and the kind of gated community. Everyone wants to be off-grid. Like either this is like, and usually actually this tends to be extractive. It's kind of interesting that for an anthropologist or an ethnographer to be looking at this, actually structure is not the thing. But then also in terms of technology, it's if you're writing about media, actually you're not dealing with technology anymore. This is what's so interesting about your writing. You end up dealing more with psychic effects or bodily effects.
Yeah, well, I want to bring infrastructure back into it, because that seems to me to be a crucial question. And I like the way Benjamin Bratton put it, at an e-flux event, you know, along the lines of, you know, can this global infrastructure actually build another one that would be qualitatively different? Or does it just keep manufacturing more of itself? There's a sort of automated quality to a kind of global infrastructure that is heavily dependent on carbon, that prices things in these weird, you know, irresponsible ways. Can it qualitatively start to build a different one? Like, that seems to be the threshold that we're at. And where it seems like the dominant forces of capital have become reactive. And it seems to me why we have this ideology about everything has to be disrupted and pivoted and all that stuff, precisely because it's not. And everything has to be innovated, precisely because there is no actual innovation going on at all. It's a non-pivot, non-disrupting, non-innovative time of pure stasis, where the ideology says all those things are going on, when really that's just apps. Yeah, it's just sort of decorative stuff. And the infrastructure doesn't change.
It was interesting what you were just saying to me before about reading about accelerationism and feeling like this was actually something that you were dealing with 10 years ago and that you were encountering 10 years ago. But even though it's about speed and acceleration, this discourse around acceleration, that actually, in a way, we're moving in circles very quickly, maybe. And we were
rather than accelerate, could be sort of extrapolate another form on a global scale out of this one. Like, that seems to be the problem. And then what role can aesthetic practices play in gluing people together around some kind of affect, of proposing ambitions, not necessarily of a Promethean kind, this is not the 20th century, of modeling, you know, practices that you might be able to scale. You know, can we actually think of what the aesthetic might do other than our own, or for our own self-advancement, you know, like we have, you know, rent to pay, all that sort of thing. But how does that kind of contribute to, you know, practices of designing, you know, the ascesis, you know, the perception of another world?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And do you see design as something which is like a more modest approach to art that can be less hampered by idealistic expectations?
There's no boundary anymore between what's media and what's design. Mm-hmm. It's really completely, you know, like it went away. There used to be things you call media, things you call design, it went away. But I think on the other side, there's no boundary between what's art and what's design and what's media. That's all one sphere. And it's a sort of, on one hand, massively commodified sphere. All those things now participate in full subsumption, and they're all commodified. But on the other hand, there might be like little interesting affordances, and to not think of them as separate seems kind of helpful, to think, you know, well, rather than think of art as just making sort of bespoke balls for freaking hedge fund managers to collect, you know, to think of art as a space where you can actually, you know, play with the construction of new forms of life. That might be what's interesting to do at the moment. Because the problem with art is it's partly dependent on the quality of the patron class. And this is the worst patron class in 200 years. Yeah? I mean, we have a world run by idiots, and idiots collect bad art. Yeah? I mean, they value contemporary art more highly than art from the past. So they've obviously lost any sense of value. So how can one, you know, make a living off that, because it's there to make a living off, but not take it at all seriously? Like, it's clearly, the art world is not where art happens anymore.
You end your essay with a kind of very, very optimistic call for kind of technical and aesthetic counterproduction. I wonder if there are any examples that you often return to, things that are happening at the moment that can function like this for you.
I think it's always a dangerous question to answer. So, like, be your own example. You know, like be your own example. Like, what is the way of, you know, the an aesthetic practice of designing something? But I can point to other writers who think along the same way. And someone who's much closer to the theme of exhaustion is Chris Krauss, whose recent writing on art is really about exactly that, of following people who are looking for ways to create practices that make a space function. You know, that's now what counts as art. And it's not relational aesthetics, it's actually, I think, something quite different to that, or you can see how that could be a confusion, because it's not really wedded to the gallery space at all. Mm-hmm. And it's not opposed to it and using it still as a point of reference. It's just irrelevant. Like, that space just becomes irrelevant. Mm-hmm. So you create and practice wherever you happen to be. So that strikes me as interesting, and Chris is more closely aligned to that rhetoric of exhaustion and failure and so on. Mm-hmm. Right? Do still have slightly Promethean tendencies. It's a temperamental thing. I think, you know, Chris might be slightly more depressive than me, and I'm slightly more manic. So, you know, like, you have your own psychological territory, and I sort of head in the other direction a little bit.
Yeah, I always worry.
I like big plans.
I always worry a bit with basing oneself in an idea of exhaustion or in a kind of negativity like this that actually will start to actually consume the possibility of actually writing about it, that if you actually understand yourself in terms of your exhaustion, that you will just take a long nap, or just you won't actually be able to articulate it. So
yeah, and it's I was talking to someone who has this fantastic Twitter presence that's all about negativity, but who gets followers who really are suicidal. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, I don't deal with that. But I get people who are manic. You know, I get people sending me their like 23-page manifestos. Kind of things. Oh, there's a certain kind of terrain you can work.
And, yeah. You know, and you have to read them all very carefully.
It's sort of like, you might want to ease off on the speed. You know? Like, taper down the coffee there. You know, like that kind of thing. So, yeah, in short, and we didn't really touch on to what extent does capital A art and finance, are they forms that sort of mirror each other? Mm-hmm. And there's a sense in which art in that form, like capital A, becomes a kind of bespoke financial commodity. Mm-hmm. And it's a system designed to kind of nominate rare classes of those that then have the sort of equivalent value as like a bond. Mm-hmm. You know, you hold a bond on somebody's debt, you have a bond on, you know, the future value of artist X. But the system works only by making artist X the one that has value as opposed to these 10,000 others. So it exactly mirrors the winner-take-all system of finance. And the form of the work itself has to be something that can be embodied in something like a stock certificate. So you can dematerialize the art, and in fact that turns out to be great, you know, because actually having a physical frickin' thing is really annoying if you're a collector. So dematerialization turned out to be the wrong strategy. The better one might be the exact opposite, you know, where it's so frickin' embodied and materialized that no one would want to collect it, because you can't flip it 10 years later. So to kind of think that as a, you know, that art gets hooked into that system and it's where the money is, but it ends up mirroring that form, whereas, you know, the goal might be not be opposed to that, because it's a lot of people make a living off that in this town. Yeah, I don't want to take that away from anybody. But how does one, you know, like, art's a day job. Yeah, if you're a successful artist, that's all fine. You have a day job. You have people who, like, you know, deliver FedEx packages for day jobs. So what? You know, but what are you really doing? What's your real work? Yeah, and it would be this other practice. Mm-hmm. Yeah, at least in my view, that's what I find interesting.
Yeah, this was one of the most interesting things to me about your essay, though, that you, where you mentioned Warhol as an example of someone who actually anticipated the financial the artwork as a financial object. Like actually, you know, he saw the whole thing coming, and we were only seeing it. We thought it was about authorship before. We thought he was somehow disintegrating the author or the celebrity. But actually, he really understood finance. I mean, there was some kind of a problem. I mean, in the last year, where the Andy Warhol Foundation, they were in charge of authenticating Warhols, and then Warhol had delegated even the signing of his works to other people. So he had already kind of disassembled the whole system, the whole structure of authenticity, and so actually you couldn't even really sustain a sale. Like collectors were starting to get really upset. The whole system already kind of dismantled it.
Yeah, I suspect he kind of got it, that art was going to be actually more like a futures trading business. And they issued a lot of stock certificates, and that, you know, came home to roost after he was dead, and is of concern to the foundation, clearly. And they used to authenticate, I think they stopped. They had this authentication, and they got sued so many times because they were not authenticating all sorts of marginal but really interesting things. Like Warhol did something with a high school in Queens. Apparently it's not a Warhol. It's like, are you kidding me? That's one of the interesting things he did, because he only did it once, as opposed to all that other stuff he did thousands of times. There's so many aspects of his practice you could kind of unthink the way it got turned into Jeff Koons and turn it back into something else. Mm-hmm. Like queer and transgender art obviously passes through Warhol. There is notions of collectivity that he called in a factory, on and on and on. It's still interesting, but to unhook it from its sort of canonic status and do something else with it, might be the goal.
Yeah. It's interesting also that you mentioned mania in relation to exhaustion, and it made me think of also how affective relations actually may be the thing that is being used or is actually replacing certain structural or class relations also within this picture. It's kind of a jump. But I was thinking of that. You also describe how this might be some kind of a new way of slicing the class structure, class solidarity.
Yeah. To what extent does the commodification of information become the platform for a new set of class relations? Yeah. But I just want, did anybody leave Facebook for Ella in the last few days? Or was it just me? Mm-hmm. And I actually didn't leave. And it's kind of interesting, all these people I know on Facebook are like, oh, let's all go and join Elo, like this new, you know, social media platform. And then everybody else is like, oh, but it's bullshit, you know, it's as bad as Facebook is, you know, like privacy, policy, TBA, you know, the design that doesn't work and so on. But I was kind of intrigued by the sort of utopian desire that was there, which I don't think is misplaced. You know, like, oh, if only we could have this mediated social life that would be utopia, where everybody could, you know, sort their stuff out together, you know, that'd be kind of awesome. And Facebook is not it, because it, you know, betrayed so many promises. So you go to the new one, and then it will betray its promise, and you go to the next one. And it's a bit like the way Jean Baudrillard talked about the black hole of the masses, that just sort of refuses to give anything back, you know. So at some point it's just, yeah, we're done with it. We're not going to do that stuff anymore, because it all relies on our unpaid labor, any value at all. We'll just go somewhere else. Like, we owe you nothing. Yeah? We owe you nothing. That's the answer to the commodification of information and affect and identity. Because in the overdeveloped world, we ran out of stuff. Like, there's no stuff that you can sell to anybody. You know? Like, ignore the fact that most of America lives below the poverty line, because no one cares about that. They don't have any money. There's nothing to sell them. But for those people you can sell stuff to, there's nothing more to sell them, so we have to make up desires and make up needs and make up products. So we're in this kind of, grotesquely involuted kind of system, of which art participates, yeah? Like, oh, then people should desire art, because everyone's got a TV and a washing machine and could ever have any money, you know? So it's just not on the table we redistribute wealth. We just have to figure out, you know, the people who can buy stuff already have everything. We have to invent new needs. Mm-hmm. But participating in that is a separation of affect, information, everything about the body except the body itself. Can that be separated from it and sold back? That's another point that we're at in this world.
How do you mean that everything about the body can be separated and sold back?
Yeah. Yeah. So you're even, you can't do it in New York State, but there's a company you like spit in a vial and send it away, and they're sending back your DNA outprint with all the diseases you're going to die from in a not terribly reliable or accurate form. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's like, oh, so you can kind of commodify your own relation to mortality and risk and stuff like that.
You know? Translation of your biology into information.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
But is it something that you relate to also as a writer and as a professor? Because you also produce information, which is something which is the product of your labor.
Yeah, it was what got me thinking about it, because you know, even in the 90s, the contracts you're supposed to sign for some piddling little article in a journal was so surreal. So it's like, oh, I'm supposed to sign away all rights in perpetuity in every known territory and any other territory that might ever be discovered in other dimensions, in every media that's ever been invented or could be invented, including all the media that could never be invented. You sign away your rights. And then you have to buy back copies of the thing you wrote. You know, and it was when, this is absurd. And it was like, this is crazy for us. Like, go talk to musicians. Like, how ridiculous that industry was. It's just insanity. It's like, this is a business? Are you kidding me? And then you go through one after the other and you sort of realize, this is ridiculous. Why are we selling stuff to these companies who, it turns out, can't actually, you know, reliably extract value from it anyway? Mm-hmm. So can you think that as a kind of class relation? It's like, I don't own a printing, you know, I don't own a publisher. I have to sell the product of my labor. But it's not quite labor anymore, because I don't work in a factory. As we mentioned, the nap seems to be part of the labor. Mm-hmm. So what is this, you know, sort of like mode of extraction of value? Mm-hmm. Like, that's the thing to think.
And what is it being done under the auspices of?
Yeah, like think, you know, alternatives to, or wrinkles internally to it that you can exploit and so on.
Mm-hmm. It reminds me of this guy who worked on Wall Street, and then he was, after he lost his job, he became hired as, maybe someone can remember his name, he was hired, or not really, not hired actually, he was an intern on the set of Black Swan, doing as an accountant, and then he realized that he was basically performing above and beyond the functions of a fully paid accountant, and became a labor activist afterwards, and he said, and he had this great thing that he said, right, he said, basically, I'm an intern, he said, and yet I can't tell my landlord that I will give him free experience as a landlord if I don't pay my rent, basically. Like, he can be an intern as my landlord. It sort of stops at a certain point where you can't take it any further.
But it's not the least reason not to do art, but to do something like design. Because if you're a designer, you demand to get paid. If you're an artist, everyone expects you to work for free. The attraction, I see this with my undergrads, they want to go do the cool stuff, which it never pays. Mm-hmm. Like, it pays for a tiny handful of people, mm-hmm. and the rest of it is unpaid labor. Right. So I said, go work for boring companies. Mm-hmm. Like, find the most boring company you could possibly work for, and the conditions are likely marginally better, the hours will be marginally better, and you might actually have some free time to do some interesting stuff. So think it that way. Mm-hmm. But maybe we should let the audience have a go at any of these topics that we've talked around. Thoughts out there in the world.
Wasn't able to follow your notion of class illusions. Do you think that inherently in the past 30, 40 years we are dealing with different modes of class illusions?
Yes.
Especially because you describe the labor in different ways.
Yes. And it's premised on thinking that there's a prior fault in class relations, and that the commodification of agriculture is actually a different thing to the commodification of manufacturing. That the landlord peasant relation is actually different from the capitalist worker relation, and that there's a third, like there's a third mode of accumulating something after capital, call it what you like. But that what I or most people I know do isn't quite labor. It might be exploited in certain ways, but it's hard to figure it in the same way as labor. It's hard to organize it in the same way as labor. And what constitutes it on the technical level is the ability to circulate, reproduce, and store information. So there's a kind of technical basis. And there's a legal basis, which is the evolution of intellectual property as a private property right, out of what were, in fact, not private property rights, but something much more interesting and complicated, where patent, copyright, trademark are the three headings, of which trademark's the only one that's like the current form. So I'd maintain there's a new kind of class relation. Now, it's not, the other ones don't go away, they're still there. There's still something like 100 million industrial workers in China, and the fate of capitalism hinges on that more than anything else. So it's minor, but I think it is a different kind of relation, different kind of modification. And commodities that actually aren't non-rivalrous anymore, because the struggle is about free information. Yeah? You can't really do that when you manufacture things. Yeah, my having this bottle of water deprives you of it. Whereas I can email you the content of that book, doesn't deprive me of it. So we have a qualitatively, you know, even ontologically different thing we've started to produce in the world. This is in a book I did 10 years ago called A Hacker Manifesto, which is quite to make that argument. Which you can get free on the internet because people have scanned it and circulated it. Yeah, but I yet got a pretty huge royalty check for it, because the weird thing is that the free stuff doesn't necessarily replace the commodity. The relation between them is complicated.
You get a royalty check for the downloads?
No, it's like, you know, I even told my publisher, I'm giving this book away free, you know that. And the legal department's like, our heads explode, we can't deal with that. So just pretend we didn't hear it. So I gave this book away free, you know, in fact, even before it was published. And yet it sold more copies than any of my other books. So it's like, oh, and I would go on tour with this book, and I'd say, I can give it to you for free, or we're selling it for $24.95, and everyone wanted both. It's like, you know, you got it free there. It's like, we want you to sign the thing and have the physical object. So there's some weird parallelism of economies going on. Yeah, so gift and, you know, the gift exchange of giving free information is actually not antithetical to the commodity, as some of us had, you know, deliriously hoped at one point. They actually fuel each other in weird, complicated ways. But anyway, that's a whole other story. Any other thoughts out there? No. Yes?
I guess, like, given the state of our, like, overdeveloped nation that you were talking about, where do you see us going? What path do you see us going on? Is it sort of incumbent upon us independently to sort of curate these private sector industries?
There's a sense in which the, you know, this mode of production seems to change at a kind of glacial pace, which is now a kind of ironic phrase because glaciers, actual glaciers, are changing very quickly. Yeah, so we have this glacial culture in the old sense, but we have this new sense of what glacial change means when they go away really fast. Yeah. It's like, you see that thing shoot by like a glacier? Yeah, let go. So our language doesn't work. Yeah, it doesn't describe the world. You know, and one needs, I think, a kind of punk rock moment to kind of go, like, screw all that dinosaur theory. Here's three chords. Like, form your genre. And in the absence of large transformative projects, are there ways that one just takes responsibility for the, like, one degree of change, you know, towards a different mode of life that all of us are capable of, without too big a stretch? You know, can one begin from that basis, just sort of orienting everybody, you know, toward a goal? And not expecting there to be some, you know, sort of marching in the streets confrontation about any of this. I don't think change ever actually happened that way. Like, you look at how capitalism itself erupted and transformed. It's actually glacial in the slow sense. Like, the breaks aren't that distinctive. So, yeah, what's like, well, how does one just orient oneself in a different way? I'm reminded also of how the Eastern Bloc just sort of evaporated overnight. And it had its dramatic moment when everybody just ran away. Like, the Berlin Wall came down and everyone just ran away. And all these states just imploded because they were just waiting for it. Yeah, like, no one really believed this stuff, except a few people who personally benefited or expected reprisals. Everybody else is like, not really working. And so in the moment came, the whole thing was, you know, fell like a house of cards. So can one have that relation to like capitalism? Of like, this civilization is not going to last. Yeah, it's just a fact. We all know it. Let's just embrace it and not, you know, like think the end times are coming, but just orient ourselves to what the next one might be.
Jumping up from your question, I would like to know if you think that art can and does have a political project.
You know, there might be specific circumstances when that's the best thing to do, but it isn't always. And to think about, like, what's the role of art that changes people's affective relation to the everyday, for example, that isn't explicitly, you know, a politics. Where an example would be sort of Manet's painting of what everyday life in early commodified capitalism was like in Paris and the outskirts. And it's kind of subtle. You sort of start to see this, you start to perceive the everyday differently. You orient yourself in it differently. And it's clearly not signaled as political art in any sense. So I think there are times when that's, you know, contextually appropriate to do. There are times when it sort of doesn't work, it just becomes another genre. It's like, oh, let's go see the political show, you know, like in exactly the same way as you go see the Jeff Koons show or whatever, you know. So there's that, and then there's also, I think, the political questions are really always more about form than content. So it's how do you change the relation, how things are produced, is kind of more important than how it looks. So that would be the question for an aesthetic practice now, is like, in what ways is it possible to change the way it's actually made? You know, and for who and how? So that would be the, you know, what are politics? Or is it still politics? Is that still useful to know? What's oriented to forms of life and changing them. Yes, sir.
I guess this is like a thought spurred on by this video, but I always find myself like within, you know, having a kind of flexibilized network firm that is mimicking kind of strategy, capital strategies past now, and you always in that same kind of capital relies on this kind of reproductive labor that isn't necessarily consumed and remunerated.
Sorry, that isn't
consumed or like in the same way that kind of labor like within the kitchen and stuff.
Yep.
And you see, so maybe they are occupying this. If it is this spare time, unremunerated labor, so you catch yourself in the system, you're always thinking that everything you're going to do, right, is just to further your future's indebtedness, right, in capital as an artist.
I think you have something there, and there'd be limits to the analogy, but it's still a useful analogy to say, you know, in what sense is all of the reproductive labor that particularly women did in the household analogous to the reproductive labor the art world does for capitalism now? And they're not the same, but one can think they're parallel kind of things, and where art wanted to be something else and outside of this. So, you know, people are still reading Adorno as if art is some great outside to quantification, and it's clearly not the case. Like, Warhol was right about this, and Adorno wasn't. There is no neat way to get out. But then how does one think more useful ways for oneself, for life, for the interiority that we all have to endure? Like, there is no outside to commodification. Or if you find one, it very soon gets included. So why be, you know, pioneering the thing outside? Because you're very pioneering of it means that it then gets included. So, all right, there is no outside. But are there ways that the interiority of work inside, call it what you like, you know, late capitalism or semi-capitalism, are there ways of working inside it, you know, sort of opens up other avenues, other spaces? So, for example, if there was a 21st century avant-garde, it would probably reverse one of the constants that all previous avant-gardes had done, which is all the previous ones publicized themselves. It's like, oh, well, maybe the way to do it now is to not do that. And maybe you actually don't want to crash through into new domains outside of what's been commodified, as the surrealists did, for example, with the unconscious, because that's now just all decoration for advertising. Like, oh, maybe you might want to maintain and preserve certain things rather than break through into something new. So the very tactics of what an avant-garde or an aesthetic movement might now be have to change, you know, given these circumstances. So it has to start with some sort of read of, you know, how does this world work now? What's its affordances? What are its dangers? And then work within that rather than the sort of wishful thinking thing of like, if only there was something outside this that was different and we could all retreat to that. It's like, not anymore.
Isn't that primarily what the Popper's said though, is took the structure and kept it the same and revealed part of the concrete of that, the underlying what's happening, so was that arguing what they're doing?
Yeah, there's different kinds of pop, because there's the American one that's sort of inside this mass manufacturing system, and it kind of understands its interiority in a way, like, you know, Warhol's repetitive prints, Jasper John's flags and things like that. But there's also like the British one where it happened in its absence. So people like Richard Hamilton are gesturing towards this sort of like shiny, massively commodified world that actually barely even begun to happen in Britain in the early 60s. The 50s is this miserable, miserable time. By the early 60s, there's just some bare hint that the corner's been turned. So there's this kind of actually interesting, you know, sort of other quality to that work. So I think if one were to look at that moment a little bit more comparatively, when there was an outside, then you see what's really distinctive about the sort of Rosenquist Warhol kind of version of it. Although I think you want to think, where were the women and what were they doing at exactly that moment? That's not a thing that can be addressed. Other than in the really interesting way that Warhol does what at the time he'd call drag queen culture. And so there's this like relation to the production of femininity that seems really, really 21st century. Right? To really answer your question, I went around it. Yeah. Hi, how are you?
Hey, I'm good. So when I met you, I was writing a 19th century historical distinction between art and criticism. Maybe not art and credit, because some artists are great critics, but certainly between the two practices. I'm interested in the difference of them, whether that's a distinction that holds in evolutions practices.
Yeah, I mean, and Matthew Arnold, I suspect, is a reference lost on Americans. We have this whole other genealogy of where literature came from. But it's kind of ironic that what we take to be these really standard fixed canons of literature and art were very consciously created, in the case of literature, only 100 years ago, which in the larger scheme of things is very recent. In art, you know, really only 50 years ago, which is incredibly recent. And in philosophy, perhaps even sooner, like the sense which the 70s is when we get this like ridiculous sense that these are the absolute things one must always read, and it's absolutely unquestionable. You know, so the meta knowledge of how you create useful pasts is no longer on the table. You're always supposed to work through these antecedents. So in other words, we've gone to this very, very kind of mannered phase of culture where it doesn't ask meta questions about how to change the past and find other pasts. You just have to take these are the great American novels and these men wrote them, you know, and how dare you question the centrality of Adorno to everything. Adorno's useless, go study Warhol, much more, he's talking about our world in a way Adorno doesn't. You're not allowed to say that, you know, because like, oh, you must be throwing away the past and it's just fashion and capitalism. Well, the blackmailers, those are the only choices, right? And we can actively produce different senses of the past. And that's where there actually is no kind of constitutive difference between art and its criticism, because each kind of constitutes the other and constitutes pasts for them that then open up new ways to think now. But it's why I kind of think we need the punk rock moment of throwing certain pasts away, with possibly with a certain amount of, you know, willful negligence, but it's the way to then clear the space to find other ones that speak to a kind of unprecedented world where, you know, the word glacial doesn't mean the same thing anymore. Yeah? So like certain literatures are not gonna explain how to deal with that. You know, certain art is not really gonna address that. You know? And in fact, even Warhol doesn't, but getting out of the Warhol complex does point you a way forward.
Maybe one last question.
That where our culture is able to reappropriate how our art and spit it back out and then reappropriate it again, that kind of cycle that's happening right now.
The sort of paradigm, I'm thinking of the English version of this, which always anticipated its own recuperation. And, you know, it was this sort of clarifying, simplifying gesture of like let's forget that past and go back to this other one. You know, let's go back to like, you know, 12 bar blues as performed by garage bands in America and we'll produce something else out of it. And it then very quickly gets sort of reabsorbed. But what was kind of clarifying is what we've done with certain kind of, you know, sort of dinosaur rock versions of the past. So when I go to MoMA, what I see is like dinosaur rock bands, basically, in visual art form. Something I want a different past, you know. Every now and then one tiny little thing, you know, gets its moment. But I was like, I want a past entirely composed of those alternate moments, rather than the sense of you got to pass through all this, you know, freaking endless guitar solo. Like, most contemporary art seems to need to be endless guitar solos, yeah? And I'm from that era when we wanted to be done with that. And yes, of course, everything gets recuperated, but what new sort of ways of linking past, present, and future gets opened up? Like, that's the crucial thing, yeah? Can we have new ways of thinking through ways between past and present that point to other futures? So that's why I think there's a sense of, you know, let's have done with, you know, sort of footnote culture. And there's so many footnotes in contemporary art now. It's kind of ridiculous. It's like, because you don't get out of grad school unless you can footnote your art, you know? It's boring. I'm not the only one who thinks it's boring, yeah? It's just boring.
I think in the interest of time. Yeah.